I think it's time for me to turn over the meeting to Jim Blinn, who's our monthly program chair for March, and go from there. So Jim Blinn, unmute and be ready.
Let's take a short musical break, and you'll see why.
Take the A train, our theme.
Thank you, Paul. That was fantastic. What a wonderful introduction. Now for Jim Blinn.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Yes, that was quite an introduction to my introduction. So our speaker today will be Marcel Simon. Marcel was my supervisor at Hewlett-Packard's Unix software operation in Florham Park. One day he took our group out to lunch at Shanghai Jazz in Madison, and that's how I learned that he was a jazz geek. He says he became a jazz geek one day in 1977 because as an engineering major at Stevens Tech, he was looking for an elective that wouldn't add to the stress of those courses. One of his friends encouraged him to sign up for a music appreciation course. Why call it jazz? So thanks or blame go to Professor Andrick, who played by way of introduction to the course Duke Ellington's Creole Love Call with Adelaide Hall's woodless vocals, as well as Charlie Parker's Coco and Charles Mingus's Better Get Hit in Your Soul. While these and other pieces opened for Marcel a portal to a world he didn't know existed, he has since spent countless hours searching dusty shelves of half-forgotten stores for instances of petroleum or aluminum discs. And he's trekked to dubious establishments to join other obsessives to view people unknown to most Americans. And he's listened and listened and listened to more and more and more of all that he could find, all to get closer to fully understanding that mysterious and compelling music. My understanding is that some of those obsessives have joined us on Zoom today. So while engaged in these dodgy activities, Marcel maintained a somewhat polished veneer of respectability. He's been married for 42 years to the most lovely and patient woman in history, Wendy, who is actually with us on Zoom today. They have raised three now men who've given them five grandchildren, which he spoils energetically. Somehow, he convinced several healthcare and technology companies to keep him employed and doing enough that he can say truthfully that he's helped define and professionalize the fields of non-mainframe information technology and non-government information security. He says that all this continually amazes him. So today, Marcel will focus on Duke Ellington's piano style with a few biographical details supplemented by excerpts from various performances recorded during Ellington's life. Marcel, the Zoom floor is yours.
Good morning. Thank you for this introduction, Jim. Yes, I remember that lunch at Shanghai Jazz. That's a nice place, by the way, which I recommend highly. So good morning, everybody. Talk about Duke Ellington and Duke Ellington's piano. And I want to thank Paul for that clip, which actually is pretty much perfect in illustrating what we'll be talking about, because clearly he's introducing the band. The band is going to follow this piano solo. And in fact, you can see him looking up at the band, making sure they're ready and so on and so forth, which is something he did a lot. We'll talk about that. And also you kind of hear him. He is, he's got the heavy left hand. There is the sort of remnants of so-called Harlem stride in his playing. You can tell he started out as a stride player, although by the time this is recorded, probably in the late 1960s, he had pretty much pared that back quite a bit. He's open to dissonance. He abstracts the melody extensively to the point that when he actually plays it straight towards the end, it's a little bit surprising because you know what he's been playing, although he's never really given you the melody at all. So very much a great illustration of Ellington's piano. And so now let's kind of come back to the beginning. And if you don't mind putting up these slides. Thank you, Joel. So underappreciated excellence. And if we can jump to the first one. The point here is that, look, everybody knows Duke Ellington. Duke Ellington, like Muhammad Ali, is one of those people, literally everyone in the world knows his name, and rightly so. But by and large, he's praised for what he composed, over 1,000 pieces, formal and some 3-minute miniatures that were meant for dancers and that he kept on playing for dancers for decades. He attracted some of the greatest musicians in the world and kept them in his band, using the royalties from his music to keep the band going. Also, he is really great at writing music for a specific personality. One of the great things that he said was, you can't write music for anyone until you know how he plays poker, which should, if you think about it, tells you something about how much he really observed people during the many, many hours that the band spent traveling on railroads, because back then you didn't travel by airplane yet. So we all know about this, but I claim, and I hope to convince you, that had he done none of those things, had he just played piano, his pianism alone would make him a first ballot Hall of Famer by acclamation. No one runs against him, you know, any imagery that you want to use. Of course, the challenge is you have to go search for his piano playing, because he did not very often feature himself, unlike, for example, Count Basie, okay? As such, you sort of have to go search his music, especially the younger he is, to find these sort of gems that tend to get not necessarily buried, but they feel small compared to the compositions and compared to the performances. So you have to listen. And in fact, I want to thank Olgaard for the opportunity to give this talk, because it has forced me to do some extensive listening to Duke Ellington's piano for the last 4 or 4.5 months. And I can't think of anything more pleasurable than that. So if we can jump to Matt Harissa, which I think from the Far East Suite. So that was Matt Harissa from the Far East Suite. And again, it illustrates a lot of what we'll talk about. Beautiful melody, power left hand, the whole thing. So what about Ellington? So he's born April 29th, 1899 in Washington, DC. It was interesting in researching this, I had always thought that, strongly thought that Ellington's parents were somewhat wealthy, especially for black people in the late 19th century. Actually, they weren't. J.E. Ellington was a butler. Daisy Ellington was a seamstress who became a homemaker when he was born. They weren't rich, but they saw themselves as members of the Black upper crust, and they told them relentlessly, you can do anything you set your mind to. They were very widely read. He was essentially an early child. He had a sister, but she was born 16 years after him. So essentially throughout his childhood, he was an only child. He got lots and lots of parental attention. Clearly they doted on him. There is a fabulous story that is told in one of his biographies, that when he was little, he would get dressed for school, and then he would stand at the top of the stairs and announce the great and mighty Duke Ellington — Duke was a childhood nickname — is ready to begin his day. And he would stand there until his parents actually stood against the wall as if they were watching him walk down. And then he would walk down very regally down the stairs to the kitchen to grab breakfast and get himself ready for school. Now, you can see any parent kind of deal with this maybe once or twice, but he did this for like months and months and months, and they let him, which is amazing to me, because I raised 3 kids. There's no way I would do this for more than once or twice, so he got lots of parental support. He began with piano. He was playing baseball at age 7 or 8, and he got hit in the head with the bat. His mother heard about this, and that was the end of his baseball playing. And she got him into piano lessons with a woman named Mrs. Klinkscales, which is about the most perfect name you can imagine for a piano teacher. And he starts hanging out with professional musicians from around middle school. And actually, he also hung out in pool halls and other places where, rather dubious characters hung out, which is sort of how he learned how to read people, and also how he developed a personal charisma that led to much older men following him for years, if not decades, through some not necessarily easy circumstances at the beginning. So it's rather interesting. Another point is that his actual major talent as a young man was not music, it was drawing. He received an NAACP scholarship, but wouldn't take advantage of it. And in fact, he left high school a couple of months before graduating to start a sign painting business, because again, drawing was so easy for him that he could sort of draw and paint the sign and then have other people go hang it and that kind of thing. And he was gonna make money that way. But the lure of music took over pretty rapidly. By 1920, he was making $10,000 a year. For context, that's $150,000 in 2023 money. Not bad for a 21-year-old who hadn't graduated from high school, okay? And that gave him a very interesting viewpoint with respect to navigating American society. He clearly saw himself as, you know, a lord among men. His parents had encouraged him to see himself this way, and I believe he did. So when he formed his bands and they would have to travel to dances and nightclubs and whatnot, rather than travel in regular trains, Duke rented out a couple of Pullman cars, and he would pay for having the Pullman cars hooked up to the rest of the train. And he and his musicians and anybody else involved with the band, so you're talking roughly 20 to 25 people, would travel in comfort in the Pullman car. He would pay the railroad so that the porters would carry their bags in and out, bring them food and drinks and, you know, whatnot. And they would travel this way in comfort and would avoid having to deal with Jim Crow segregation. And Duke did this essentially throughout his career into the 1950s, until in effect segregation died away by itself as a result of the civil rights movement and air travel started to take over. Essentially, he took himself and his band out of the context of Jim Crow, so he wouldn't have to deal with, you know, any white people telling him go sit in the back of the bus or anything like that. He just bypassed it. And he willingly paid out money to make this happen. That tells you a lot about Duke Ellington. Duke Ellington never said a word about politics in his entire career. But how also he also behaved as if any sort of attempt to put him down for being a black man was just foundationally ridiculous. And as a result, people didn't mess with him. And there are lots and lots of stories of other jazz musicians having to deal with very painful Jim Crow issues and Jim Crow problems. You know, Thelonious Monk ended up getting arrested because he didn't respond to a shopkeeper who thought he might be trying to steal something. And then he ended up getting arrested for that, for example. Duke never had that problem because Duke took himself out of it. Anyway, let's move on. Now that we have a sense of, you know, Ellington the person, what about Ellington the pianist? So as a young man, his pianist style was very florid, but the older he got, the more spare it begins. And we can move to the next slide. With wide distances, and we saw that in the clip that we just looked at in the beginning, wide distances between left and right hands on the keyboard, he tends to strike the keys hard, often dissonantly, and the more so over time. And paradoxically, when he plays ballads, he's fairly romantic. And there are very audible links to stride masters such as James P. Johnson. And I'll explain what stride is in the next slide, as well as to peers such as early, well, I wouldn't say pioneers of the music, but early first generation jazzmen such as Sun Ra or Mary Lou Williams and others. He is a clear and acknowledged influence on giants like Thelonious Monk, Randy Weston, and others. And the dissonance in his playing attracted a later generation, which is very under-assessed. Cecil Taylor is very much an Ellingtonian pianist, which folks don't think about that because people think of Cecil Taylor as an avant-gardist, as difficult, and so on. That's not true. Cecil Taylor is a child of Duke Ellington, as is Mal Waldron, and so on. And then you have others, which again, folks don't think about. Herbie Hancock starts out his career as an Ellingtonian who became a lot more diffuse and modernistic while playing with Miles Davis. So people don't think of Herbie as an Ellingtonian, but he is. Anyway, now I have to be careful with this, and I just sort of asserted a whole bunch of things. Musicians tend to hate it when folks like me play the spot the influence game. Okay, they don't like that because they feel that it diminishes their own creativity and what they contribute, you know, their own personality into their music by just reducing them to a series of influences. So they don't like it very much when interviews spend a lot of time exploring who influenced you, you know, how, what's in your playing and that sort of thing. So as a result, they don't talk about it much. So in a lot of cases, we don't really know for certain, except maybe in passing comments. But I believe, and we'll hear some of this, that these influences are fairly clear and fairly obvious. So let's jump on. So Duke Ellington is a stride pianist, okay? He was encouraged from childhood to play so-called society music, which is kind of, if you think about it, a type of stride music that is played by not professional musicians who are perhaps not as good to play, more genteel way of stride and so on. And as we've talked about, he starts making money at music from his early teens because, you know, the rich people in the Washington DC area in Maryland and Virginia and whatnot, rich people would leave Washington in the summer because Washington was not a good place to be. The marshes of the river meant a lot of mosquitoes. It was hot, it was unpleasant, humid. So they would leave, they would go to country homes. And this being the, early, very early 1920s, the roaring 20s, they would host parties that they would bring musicians to. Most of these musicians were Black. They would be hired, they'd make a lot of money. They were expected to not interact with the guests at the party, of course, but you know, there was an opportunity for a young musician to make quite a bit of money, as we've talked about. So he's encouraged to do this. Society music is a more genteel version of the so-called Harlem stride piano tradition, which is characterized as you have very high speed runs in the right hand and very wide interval chords played in the left hand. And because you have wide intervals, the left hand has to do a lot of jumping back and forth, which was called striding. So you would have to stride across octaves and so forth. So that's why it's called stride. Unfortunately, there are no recordings of Ellington before he left Washington, D.C. to come to New York, which is, of course, Washington, D.C. is a very small town in the jazz world. If you wanted to make it as a jazz musician, you had to go to New York, which he does in the mid-1920s. And we don't have any recordings of him in Washington, but let's listen to a couple of sort of passages in tunes. So that was Birmingham Breakdown, and let's continue. Let's play Washington Wobble as well, and then we'll stop and talk about it a little bit. Okay, so two solos, which are part of, you know, other of compositions where the rest of the band plays. I abstracted out the rest of the band to focus on Ellington's piano. This is pretty classic stride, okay? You know, any jazz musicians who's listened to stride at all will recognize this. Yes, this is pretty normal stride. Again, you can hear the strong left hand, you can hear the big wide movements and so on and so forth. Now, this is early, this is 1927. Ellington comes to New York in late 1925 or early 1926. He's leading a band by mid-1926 and he's recording by early 1927. So this is pretty early stuff. This is Ellington, the young man. Now let's go to Black Beauty, which he wrote for Florence Mills, one of his first major compositions. In just a year, you can see how the piano playing has evolved. Things are becoming a bit more spare, less of a flood of notes. And to give you a sense of things, I'm going to jump to those next two pieces in a minute. Soda Fountain Rag, we're going to play next, is was Ellington's first ever composition. He wrote that in 1913 when he was 14 years old. And this was very much a way of, for him to look back in 1937. That was the one and only time he ever recorded Soda Fountain Rag. And in fact, it's a radio performance that was recorded off the air. The album was released and went out of print and has never ever been reissued. I was very fortunate to be able to get to listen to a copy from the good folks at the Institute of Jazz Studies in Newark, which is, I believe, the only place that I know that has had it. I have never seen this record out in the wild ever in 40 years of searching. So thank you to the Institute for letting me kind of listen to it and get a copy. So both Soda Fountain Rag and Lots of Fingers that we'll hear next are kind of Ellington in his 30s, looking back on his playing as a young man. He wasn't really playing like that anymore. But again, I want to give you a sense of the sort of things that he would do as a young man, which he was expected to do as a young man. So let's go to Soda Fountain Rag. Thank you. So you really get a sense of kind of what a young Duke Ellington would sound like at, you know, some party out in the Virginia countryside or whatever. But you also hear with Black Beauty how his style was beginning to evolve from that as early as the late 1920s. So these last two performances are sort of him looking back. This is not at all indicative of what he was doing in the 30s. So if we'll jump to the next slide, and we kind of hear him, and you can see right away how things get different. So let's go to Going Out the Back Way, which is kind of a part of a performance with Johnny Hodges. So that bass player is Jimmy Blanton, whom we'll talk about in a couple of minutes, but and he's swinging. I love this piece. So Ellington is still very much in the Stride framework, but here we are in 1941. He's a lot less florid. He's a lot less, you know, showing off. He's more spare, really digging into making each note, each chord count more. And for what it's worth, this is part of, I put lead in quotes here, because Ellington, during the 1938 to 1941 period, he had a series of recording sessions that were nominally led by his sidemen, one Johnny Hodges, one Rex Stewart, and one was Barney Bigard. And I think there might have been another one. But they were nominally led by the sidemen. It was a way for them to make leader money, but it was Ellingtonian musicians from the Ellington band with Duke Ellington at the piano playing Duke compositions. So it was kind of small group Ellington stuff with Ellington supposedly sitting back. And the music is great, and I strongly recommend you checking this out if you want to. So you can hear that as an adult, he's now about 40 years old, he is moving away from, you know, let me show you how good I am at playing the piano, and he's just gonna make him count for more. Now, this was a piano solo as part of an ensemble performance, but when the piano is featured, like on the next couple of excerpts, you can hear this much more clearly. So why don't we go to Jump In Room Only? You can continue. Go to solitude. So again, you can hear on ballads, there is a lot of romanticism in the playing, which paradoxically, as it becomes more and more spare and more abstracted in later years, the romanticism thins out a bit. Very interesting way, listening to Ellington on ballads over the years, how his playing evolved. So a fascinating comparison that we can make. So we heard Jimmy Blanton before. Jimmy Blanton revolutionized bass playing in jazz. Jimmy Blanton, 19 years old, essentially came in with the revolutionary concept that bass players should solo like everybody else. No one else did that. Solos were rare. A bassist might play one solo for the entire evening. Blanton asserted that bassists should solo on almost any tune. So, and he had the chops to back that up. Very sadly, he died very young, age 23, of tuberculosis. And Ellington in 1940 took him into the studio and made a, you know, recorded sessions, which are absolutely precious, by the way, highly recommended, essentially so that folks could hear Jimmy Blanton play, not just with the orchestra. And he went back late in his life, 1973, December 1973, and recorded a whole album of duets with Ray Brown called This One's for Blanton. And he redid Pitter Panther Patter, and the comparison between the two is just fascinating. So why don't we play both of those so you can kind of listen to them side by side and hear how Ellington sounds 33 years apart. So again, 1973, the left hand is far more prominent. It's less smooth. It's more open to dissonance. It really shows you the evolution. It also shows you how much bassists have to ratchet up their game. You know, Ray Brown obviously is even more of a virtuoso than Jimmy Blanton was. Well, that's because Blanton forced everybody else to do that. After Blanton, you could no longer just be, you know, playing thump, 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 four, four, and be done with it like it was possible before. And essentially all the bass players had to kind of go back and woodshed for a while and get better. Charles Mingus has said that very, very loudly, and you can kind of hear it. All right, let's move on to the next slide and kind of hear. So Ellington by the 1950s. So that quote, our pianist will steal the show. By the 1950s, Ellington sort of stopped counting down the cadence to tunes. So instead of kind of, you know, one, you know, and kind of launching into a tune, he would play a short solo. Musicians would know by what he was playing what the tune was. It gave them time to go find their music. It gave them time to get ready. And it gave them a little bit of room to be a pianist, as he said. And then sometimes he, instead of just playing, you know, a chorus or so as an intro and opener into a tune, he would really dive in and do a long, so a lot of playing, which by all reports could be stunning in their experimentalism. Of course, most of the stuff was not recorded, and that's too bad, because This would be something that, you know, the band would go somewhere and do a dance, and he would kind of do this long piece as a way for folks to go get a drink and get off the dance floor for a minute and rest up and maybe mop up sweat from their brow, that kind of thing. And this is where he would kind of dive into the piano. He would open up one of these episodes by saying, "And now our pianist will steal the show." So I reuse the phrase, okay? His playing becomes ever more economical. He works by subtraction. I use the word austere. Not everybody agrees with me on Ellington's piano being austere. You listen and you can tell me what you think. Also, his playing gets hard, as if his fingers are heavier and they get heavier over time. So let's kind of illustrate that with In a Mellow Tone from Blues in Orbit. We are pretty far away from Washington Wobble and Birmingham Breakdown by now, right? I mean, yes, 30 years have gone by, but this pianist is not in a hurry to play. He's not trying to sort of pour out notes by the buckets to show you how good he is. He knows how good he is. Let's go to Congo. So I highly recommend the entire Piano in the Foreground album. It's a great record. And you know, I think I've got another excerpt from that. The other point about, you know, Ellington is there's near constant dissonance in his stuff. Near constant dissonance. And he played a lot of familiar tunes over and over again. And he plays them in deeply abstracted fashion, where he's just kind of sketching at the theme in a lot of ways, rather than stating it. So let's kind of enter the second set of excerpts with things ain't what they used to be. Keep going, just, you know. Thank you. Yeah. So that summertime is fascinating because he almost never tells you the theme straight. Okay. I mean, we just heard he played the A strain of the theme of summertime, but he never played it per se. He sort of danced around the note, abstracted the theme. This is something that Ellington did a lot. And in fact, it not only did it do that a lot, he did a lot more and more as we went on. In fact, the Take the A Train that we heard at the beginning did some of that as well, where he sort of abstracted the theme for two choruses. And then in his third chorus, kind of played the theme straight as a way to kind of get lead into the band playing, okay? Weary Blues, likewise. Weary Blues is an old, old tune. It's not even an Ellington tune. It's an old tune that he plays with Johnny Hodges. So he plays this out of tempo, you know, with the bass kind of giving this leitmotif pedal point for him to play over before rhythm comes in, before tempo comes in. And, you know, Johnny Hodges gives a classic solo on this, very, very, very beautiful. But his piano is, again, dissonant. It's economical. It's not giving you the theme, although it's hinting at it. This is kind of what core Ellington is as of the 1950s. And it's sort of, it's a pivot to where he continued on throughout the rest of his life. Now, ironically, when he's not the lead voice on a ballad, he remains the romantic. And it's very interesting. In the early 1960s, he does a series of kind of meetings with other lead voices. There is a classic session with Louis Armstrong. There is one with Coleman Hawkins. There is this one with John Coltrane. And in all of those, where he's not so much deferring to the other musician as letting the other musician take the lead. And on ballads, the romanticism of Ellington comes through. So let's play that in a sentimental mode. So again, you can hear this is a, you know, an old romantic, yeah, but who's letting Coltrane lead here? You know, he's not giving the theme at all. He's just kind of playing this beautiful figure that he's repeating over and over again. All right, let's move on to the next slide, because as he goes, in my opinion, he is a godfather to the avant-garde. He starts experimenting with out of tempo playing. So Ad Lib on Nippon is a fascinating piece. First of all, it's long. Ad Lib on Nippon is 11 minutes long, which is exceedingly rare. I mean, Ellington did a lot of work on suites that could be album long or, you know, where, but the suite would be made up of multiple parts that were 4, 5, 6 minutes long. For him to play a single piece 11 minutes long is very out of character for him. And it's also, the thing has, it's played in three different tempos. When the orchestra comes along, there are orchestral passages that are wildly different from the solo pieces. And the piano that he plays on it is, well, let's play it.
Thank you.
And then, of course, there's Diminuendo and Crescendo in Blue at Newport Festival in Newport, Rhode Island, 1956. So this is a very famous performance. This sort of was a comeback concert. Johnny Hodges had just returned to the band after 5 years on his own. And so this was a real celebration of Johnny Hodges' return. Also in the interval between the diminuendo and the crescendo sections, Paul Gonsalves played this epic 27 chorus tenor sax solo that, as David Murray has put it, opened musicians' ears to the possibilities of extended improvisation. And there was a woman, of course, at the time in Newport, Rhode Island, that was kind of where the big money play people would go and spend their summers and stuff. And apparently there was a woman in a fur coat and diamonds, wearing a fur coat in July. I have no idea why, but anyway, who started dancing. She threw the fur coat away. She started dancing down the aisles, which is correct, by the way. There are photos of this. You can, the performance, you can find it on YouTube with the photos that will kind of tell you. And as a result, other people started dancing in the aisles along with her. Paul Gonsalves playing the tenor solo went right to the front of the stage, playing to this woman. It was a whole thing where it ignited a near riot. The crowd just refused to, it was supposed to be the end of the concert. The crowd refused to leave. They had to play all kinds of more pieces just to calm the crowd down. But I don't want to talk about any of that because I want to talk about Duke's piano. So let me set the stage for you. So Gonsalves just finished. He's drenched in sweat. He's got to walk back from the front of the stage back to his place in the orchestra. And he's got to gather himself so that he can take his part in, you know, the series of ensemble choruses that are going to form the crescendo session. So to give him some time, let him kind of put himself together, Ellington plays three choruses, a three chorus solo. And he does something remarkable. So the first chorus is pretty straight. You know, again, we're talking three guys playing the blues. Then the second chorus, first he turns the beat around, and then he immediately turns the beat around again. Now, turning the beat around is a very common device in improvisation, but the rhythm section was not expecting him to turn it around again immediately. And so they're unsure of what he's going to do. And so the whole performance kind of floats in anticipation of what's going to come next. And Duke himself pauses for a half beat, where as if he is not sure of where to go himself, whether he's going to continue experimenting or whether he's still going to start to pull it back and get ready for the band to come back in. He chooses to sort of pull it back, and he spends the rest of the second chorus coming back to the normal rhythmic line. And then he spends the third chorus kind of getting ready for the band to launch. But we can imagine someone like Cecil Taylor hearing the first half of that second chorus and asking himself, gee, I wonder what would happen if we stay out there over floating rhythm where the rhythmic signature is no longer clear and we can go any of the four possible ways that we could on the beat. Let's play that. Thank you. So I cut it off right as the band comes in. Now, what's interesting is that if you listen to Cecil Taylor is recorded in September 1956 in Boston, and again in July 1957 at the next Newport Festival. The album hits shelves in retail shelves in November 1956. So Cecil in Boston has not yet heard this. Cecil in 1957 has almost certainly heard this, because the album was a sensation. Cecil's playing in July 57 is rhythmically looser from his playing in September 1956. Now, we don't know, because no one, Cecil has never said this. Cecil has acknowledged being influenced by Duke Ellington, but he hasn't said, I heard diminuendo and crescendo in blue and it influenced my playing this way. So we don't know that, but it's a very interesting circumstantial evidence in how it kind of touched on how his playing evolved over the year from the transition LP of 56 and the Newport session of 57. Now, the whole of the Money Jungle album, that's a truly remarkable album, because if some other pianists had done this, we would have been saying, oh, that guy's an avant-garde. It isn't an avant-garde record. It's hard to describe just how amazingly different Money Jungle is, okay? And maybe it's the circumstances of the recording. So Mingus, Charles Mingus, the rhythm section is Duke on piano, Charles Mingus on bass, and Max Roach on drums. Mingus and Max were both leaders in their own right, had been for 15 years, very well recognized. Both of them were listening very closely to some of the innovations of Ornette Coleman and others in the early 1960s. So for Duke to reach out to them is quite a stretch, okay? So Mingus showed up. He had brought some pieces that he had written that he thought that he would get the opportunity to play with Duke Ellington. And when he was informed that no, they would only record Duke's pieces and he could put away his music because they weren't going to play that, he got pissed off. Mingus tended to be a bundle of contradictory feelings at the best of times. So this sort of things really annoyed him. And in fact, he packed up his bass and started to leave. Duke literally caught him at the elevator and kind of talked him into staying and playing the session, okay? On top of that, you know, you've got these folks who've been leaders for 15 years who were in their early 40s playing with this old man who's 63. And is there a sense of, you know, let's show up the old guy by tricking him and crossing him up? Who knows? None of these folks are still alive to tell us. The A&R guy who kind of supervised the session, he's gone too. So we don't really know any of this for sure, but there clearly are creative tensions going on that Duke completely leans into, okay? So, Let's start with the Money Jungle. Okay. Again, you can hear Mingus is fighting with Duke here. And that's even more so in Very Special. Well, let's jump to that right away because, you know, we can hear this. You can kind of hear how Mingus is trying to lead here and Duke is not letting him. And kind of Duke is not paying attention. Well, it's not like the Duke is not paying attention to what he's doing, but Duke is not letting him lead. And Mingus keeps on trying. And towards the end of that excerpt, he kind of gives up and he starts, you know, walking a 4-4 as a way to move into a supporting role. Again, is this conflict? Is this the remnant of Mingus's annoyance and trying to sort of blow up this thing and show up Duke? We don't really know, so that's why I have a question mark here. But wouldn't have I would have loved to be a fly on the wall in that studio, okay? Because musically, these pieces are riddled with tension, okay? And that results in mass dissonance. And let's jump to REM Blues and hear that. Okay, so REM Blues is just a straight 12-bar blues, you know, very basic, but you hear the dissonance in the left hand, right? Now let's continue with Caravan, and you can hear the weight in his left hand. Pretty heavy. Fleurette Africaine is a ballad, very romantic ballad. And in fact, band versions of Fleurette Africaine are just achingly pretty. And the romanticism remains, but it's turned inside out. Play for that, go ahead. And then your final example, I mean, the whole album is remarkable this way. The final example is Warm Valley. Now, Warm Valley is a tune that dates back to the late 1930s. It was with the orchestra, it was a feature for Johnny Hodges, who plays, of course, alto sax, a very romantic, actually, a critic has said it's the most erotic piece he's ever heard. And I understand where that's coming from. My teacher, Professor Andrik at Stevens, called Warm Valley couch music because he says this is music for two people on a couch. And I'll let you imagine what the activities are. In fact, I'll let you imagine what is being referred to by the words Warm Valley. It has to do with anatomy, and I'll leave it at that. But you can kind of get a sense where this is a very tender is not the right word. It's a charged atmosphere. Here, Ellington completely reinterprets Warm Valley. Let's go ahead and play that. Again, with those chords, those left-hand chords, that's not couch music. That is not designed to stimulate, you know, romantic advances, right? He's playing the theme, but not the way it's played at any other time in Ellington's career. Why did he choose to reinterpret Warm Valley this way? I have no idea, but I think it's fascinating. And again, to me, Money Jungle is an avant-garde record, full stop. And for Ellington, a guy who'd been around for right at the beginning, to play this and to leverage the circumstances of the recording to produce this music, well, that alone, that album alone, makes him one of our great pianists ever, I think. So anyway, I want to touch a bit on, let's go to the next slide, on kind of sketching out Ellington's influences. Because if you're going to say that he's influential, you have to show it and prove it. And of course, proving it is very difficult because, again, most of these people don't really talk about this because, again, musicians don't really like to discuss those things. But we can talk about how Ellington influences both near contemporaries like Mary Lou Williams and Sun Ra, who were about 10 years younger than him, as well as the next generation of musicians, as well as the others who come after that. So Mary Lou Williams was a total badass of piano. She's born in 1910. She took over the leadership and the arranging and the piano in Andy Kirk's 12 Cloud of Joy big band in 1929, meaning she was 19 years old in Tulsa, and then moved with the band to Kansas City. Mary Lou Williams is a boss lady to musicians, and she remained a boss lady to musicians from 1929 all the way until she left and rejoined the Ancestors. If you look at the Great Day in Harlem photo that was taken for Esquire magazine in 1958, she is right up front talking with Marianne McPartland, and it's the music. There's a video, a film of kind of what led to that photo being taken, which kind of captures the musicians chatting and assembling for the photo. The musicians put her up front. Musicians, as you can hear somebody says, Mary Lou needs to be up front. Sun Ra, of course, Sun Ra arrived on Earth May 22nd, 1914, so he was about almost exactly 15 years younger than Ellington. He was composing by age 12. He was leading a band by 1934, age 20, in Alabama. His first big job in Chicago was arranging and playing for the Fletcher Henderson Orchestra in 1946. So while Sun Ra doesn't really start recording, actually there are recordings of Sun Ra in the 40s, which are not findable at all. But Sun Ra as a leader doesn't start recording until the 1950s. So talking about influences within Sunrise Music is complex because decades have gone by, but I think you'll hear it. So let's play Mary Lou. This is Holy Ghost from her Zoning album when she returned to active playing. Let's continue to L is a Sound of Joy. So are we talking influences, or are we talking about people who bathe in the same waters as young people? We can't know this for sure, but again, we can think about it. Clearly, these two pianists are very much coming out of the same space and doing the same things, you know, the heavy left hand, the dissonance, and so on, as Ellington is doing. Are we talking influences? Probably, but we will never know that for certain. Now, these next two, Thelonious Monk and Randy Weston, are on record as saying that they are, Randy Weston says, I'm a child of Duke Ellington. Thelonious Monk also said, yeah, I listened to Duke as a young man, as a child, and as a young man, and I decided to take my style from him. So this we know for sure. So let's go to Caravan. Again, here you hear the stride left hand. Monk was a stride pianist. Let me say this again. Monk was a stride pianist. And if you listen to Monk across the year, every once in a while, he gives you a hint of it. In fact, here, he's almost winking at you to let you know that he's in on the joke that he is doing stride, except refracted through the Thelonious Monk aesthetic. Let's go on to Mystery of Love. So I had excerpts of this one, which was the part of the introduction, and another excerpt, which was the piano playing that he plays under the tenor saxophone player solo, and a third, which was Randy's own solo. And it literally took me weeks to decide which of these I was going to include, because both in terms of how fantastic the music is and in terms of how well it illustrates what I'm trying to say here, I literally could not decide. So I hope you forgive me that I picked the intro. I highly recommend this entire performance. The album is a relatively large group, not quite a big band, but it's a fairly large group. This is an anomaly. It's kind of three guys, no drums, the bass player, Randy Weston on piano, and now I'm blanking on his name, on tenor saxophone. Fabulous performance. Very Ellingtonian in nature. But there are others. And I wanted to pick these next two because they are so unexpected. No one thinks of Herbie Hancock as an Ellingtonian pianist. And yet the influence is there. Herbie is 22 years old right here. He's a young man. He hasn't yet started playing with Miles. During his years with Miles, his playing became far more abstracted and far more modernistic. But as a young man, well, hear the Ellingtonian influence. Again, very Ellingtonian, okay? Unexpected, but very absolutely present. And lastly, Cecil Taylor, the great experimentalist, the great avant-gardist, however you want to call it. I mean, it's weird to think of music that was done 60 years ago as avant-garde, which is why I don't like to use the word avant-garde, but hey, whatever. OP stands for Oscar Pettiford, and it's recorded in the early 1960s, comes out in the early 1970s on a New York City R&B album. And this is Cecil Taylor playing 12 bar blues. People who are unkind have said he's chain whipping the 12 bar blues. I absolutely don't agree with that, but he's playing deep respect to Duke Ellington, even though it's his own stuff. So in conclusion, next slide. Duke Ellington is a major piano voice in our jazz tradition. One that was cloaked by his own composing and arranging so that it's too easy to not be aware of how brilliant it actually was. He was a Harlem Stride musician, a Harlem Stride school pupil, but he gradually purged the florid excesses of regular stride playing from his own. His mature style spans the entire history of jazz piano. He is a significant influence, although one that, interestingly and strangely, is a bit understudied. Even scholars at the Duke Ellington Society tend to focus more on his composing and his band leadership than they do on his piano playing. But he is all over other major voices in jazz, ones that themselves have influenced countless other musicians. So by proxy, Duke kind of literally is on top of some large subsection of all jazz pianists. And certainly no one has ranged in influence both as wide and as deep as he has. not just an influence, but in his own playing, let alone doing both. Duke Ellington, I believe, is one of our major pianists, and we are very lucky that the comparatively little piano that he left behind compared to the rest of his music is so rich and so great as it is. On the next slide, I have a few references for those who want to sort of check what I've been saying here. And other than that, let's go to questions.
Okay. We have one hand raised at this point. Ron Weinger, you're first.
Hi. Yes. In 1962, Columbia released Basie meets Ellington album. Can you comment on the story behind that? If the two of them met before, since they both had contemporary careers in bands.
Yes. So Basie and Ellington knew each other going all the way back to the 1930s when Basie came to New York for the first time. So they did not see themselves as competitors at all. They did not see themselves as, you know, folks who somehow should be antagonistic to one another. Of course, they both traveled constantly going, you know, to gigs with their respective bands. And so I don't think that they were close to one another. Ellington personally was somewhat distant from almost everyone. His son, Mercer Ellington, has said that he was a very distant father, for example. So I don't know that Ellington was close to Basie. I don't think so. But they certainly had no antagonism towards, you know, anybody, towards each other, sorry. The album, The Count Versus Meets the Duke, it's called First Time, The Count Meets the Duke.
Yes.
That's not focused on piano at all. In fact, there are several cases where Ellington does not play piano because he's conducting. It's the two orchestras taking advantage of stereo, Ellington's orchestra on one channel, Basie's orchestra on the other channel. So that's why you don't have any excerpts. That's why I don't have any excerpts from it, because there is really not a whole lot of significant piano on that, certainly not from Ellington.
Thank you. Mike Katz.
Yes, Marcel. I've been listening to jazz since I was 12 years old, and I enjoyed your presentation very much. Really gave a very interesting perspective on Ellington and his pianism. I was wondering if you would comment on the relationship between Duke and his longtime collaborator, Billy Strayhorn.
Yes. Yes. So I did not obviously include any excerpts of Duke and Strayhorn playing together. There are such performances on the Piano Reflections album from 1953. Duke and Strayhorn have very different piano styles. Strayhorn is a lush romantic pianist. Duke, as I hope you heard, is not. Duke is not a romantic pianist at all. And although as composers and arrangers, they kind of went together like left hand hooking up with right hand, they could finish each other's arrangements and you could not tell kind of who had done what, who had written what. They were very close to one another. When Billy Strayhorn died of cancer in 1967, Ellington did a whole album of Strayhorn music called, and his mother called him Bill, which is fantastic. It's one of Ellington's greatest records. Strayhorn wrote pieces, take the A-Train, for example, with Strayhorn, but also Blood Count and Upper Manhattan Medical Group, you know, all kinds of things that are jazz classics. Personally, Strayhorn is a very admirable figure. Strayhorn was a gay man who lived an out life in the America of the 1940s and 50s. Pause and think about that for a second. And he did it without apology. There's a biography of his, which I don't have. I've kind of read parts of it. I haven't read the whole book. but you know, what I've read is absolutely fascinating. So the Piano Reflections album and their piano duets, very, very interesting stuff. I chose not to include any of that because obviously we're not talking about Billy Strayhorn's piano, we're talking about Duke's piano, and a discussion or a contrasting discussion of Duke and Strayhorn playing would kind of take us down a fairly major avenue that would have made this talk even longer. And that's why I chose not to do that.
I mean, do it another time.
Yeah. So it was just one of those, you can't cover everything. So.
And the next person with a hand raised is Jim Landwehr.
Very interesting. Was there any connection between Duke and Dave Brubeck? Their careers must overlap somewhat, I guess.
I'm sure they met at festivals and whatnot, okay? Because, you know, they travel the same circuit. I don't know of them having had any kind of personal friendship or relationship that way, so.
Okay, oh, DJ Perron.
Yes, thank you very much. It's very enlightening. I always thought of Duke Ellington as a band leader. Now I'm seeing him more as a pianist. The question I have, you partly answered that. It's about his relation. It's about Count Basie. When you talked about Ellington's way of playing that was economical, that's the word you used. It was economical. That reminds me of Count Basie, who was a super economical in his playing. So the question is, what do you personally think of Count Basie piano playing, and where did Count Basie got his style? Was he influenced by Duke, or does he come before, after? How do you place him?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. So Count Basie is from Red Bank, New Jersey, born in Red Bank, New Jersey. Yeah. But Count Basie comes of age musically in Kansas City. So Count Basie was playing piano before as a young man. He's with a band. The band ends up breaking up in Kansas City, and he finds himself stranded in Kansas City, unable to come home to New Jersey. So that's how Count Basie ends up in Kansas City. He makes the best of it. He sort of joins Benny Moten's band, and he eventually takes over leadership of the band. And that's how the Count Basie Orchestra comes to life. Count Basie in Kansas City, these guys. So Count Basie before World War II, the so-called Old Testament Basie Band, to distinguish them from the 50s and later Count Basie Orchestra, New Testament Basie. Old Testament Basie was a band jam-packed with soloists, okay, Lester Young and Sweet Citizen and oh God, so many others. Basie obviously would have, and he took full advantage of the fact that he was band leader to sort of make sure he'd play solos. Yes, Basie starts out as an economical, unlike Duke, who starts out as a very florid pianist, who becomes economical. Basie starts out economical and becomes more economical. As Professor Andrick put it, Basie kind of in his early days would be play one note, walk around the piano, play the next note, walk around the piano, play the next note. As he gets older, it's, you know, play a note, walk around the piano twice, and then play another note, and then maybe think about it, walk around the piano a couple of times, and then maybe a couple more times, and then play the third note kind of a thing, okay? Basie became very economical, made every note count. Basie is also a stride pianist, although one that's very well disguised, because stride doesn't really lend itself to economy. So if you're economical and you play stride, that's going to sound kind of odd, which is why a lot of people don't realize that Basie is a stride pianist, okay? So I think of Basie and Ellington as pianists that came from very similar sources, that evolved in very similar ways, but I believe evolved independently of one another.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take a turn at this point. First of all, I am so delighted by your presentation. Others are going to say more about that. They're beautifully curated selections that you play for us, and wonderfully organized commentary. And I know it's clear this was a very big labor of love for you, but I certainly hope that you will consider doing a similar deep dive on another musician that you love and come to us and give us another presentation. But anyway, that's for the future. Jim, let me just ask you this. Jim Blaine told me that you actually do a weekly sort of internet radio program commentary. Do you want to say something about that?
Sure, I do. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to sort of tell you about this. Starting late last year, so late 2022, I started doing a show on the community internet radio station called Radio Free Montclair. My wife and I lived in Montclair for 23 years. We're in West Orange now, but you know, close enough. And they've been kind enough to sort of give me an hour and a half of airtime. The show plays at 5 p.m. Every day, 5 to 6:30. A new show drops every 2 weeks. The next show should drop this Thursday, and repeats every day from 5 to 6:30 for the 2 week interval, and then a new show begins and that sort of thing. So the show is called Ancient to the Future, which is a phrase that I kind of repurposed or adapted from the Art Ensemble of Chicago. Their catchphrase was Great Black Music, Ancient to the Future. And that's kind of what I look to explore, the multiplicity of branches of the great tree of great Black music, not just jazz, but you know, there are many Black musics out there. There's blues, there's gospel, there is Caribbean music, there is, you know, zydeco, there is African music, there's Afro pop, there's Afro jazz, there are jazz musicians from India, from the Middle East, North Africa, Central Africa, South Africa, and they are all very different from one another. The tree of the great Black music is everywhere, and I'm glad that I have an opportunity to explore that and share it with, you know, listeners.
That's a great opportunity for us. Thanks. Mark Kamianowski.
Yes, hi. Marcel, thank you very much. I love your passion for jazz. And one interesting thought. First of all, the presentation, can you send that copy to us? I'd love to reference some of the items that you you brought up.
Sure, absolutely. Paul Tukey, and Paul, by the way, I want to give him full credit. He added a lot of the photos to, I only had the photo on the title page, and he added the photos that kind of made the presentation a lot more lively. And thank you for that, Paul. So if you don't
mind
sharing it with everybody, I'd appreciate it.
I will do that.
And one more thing, Marcel, it's interesting about the dissonance where you said at one point Duke allowed another player in the band take over while he's, you know, leading on. And it's, I guess that was always a problem with me. I'm a pop kind of guy, you know, that, you know, I want to hear the melody and I don't mind the breakout, you know, of some riffs. But it's interesting, as you said, that at one point they were fighting who is really going to take the lead, not a melody. But it's, I always wondered, and of course, unfortunately, that always bothered me, like, how come I can't hear that melody? And I guess they meant to do that, or as you said, Duke allowed his counterpart, whether the, you know, the bass player or a horn, to take over that quote dissonant, I don't want to say melody, but the dissonant lead. It's fascinating how, I guess, it's a lot of give and take in jazz, where, you know, obviously in pop and rock and everything, it's so, there is one, most of the time there's a vocalist, most of the time there is a guitar lead, piano lead, etc. It's funny how the jazz folks worked, and I wish I could, and it's good that you gave me an understanding. I feel now I can take it all in and probably be more more understanding.
So again, I have to repeat, we don't know that there was fighting going on, and when I say fighting, I don't mean physically, but you know, that there was competition going on or conflict going on between right. Duke on piano and the rhythm section on the Money Jungle album. But it certainly sounds that way because, right. you know, you can kind of hear Mingus trying to pull the music in one direction and right. Duke trying to pull the music in another direction, okay? And for the excerpt that I had, as the excerpt ends, you can kind of hear Mingus give up on trying to take over and pull the music in one direction, and right. Mingus sort of settles into playing the classic 4/4 walking figure that most bass players use. Again, was that conflict? Was that just them being creative?
Right, right, yeah.
We discussed it beforehand. We don't know. We have no idea. So that's my interpretation.
Very good. Right, thank you. I'm sorry, so many questions. Okay.
As an aside, let me point out to everybody that Mark is a recently joined member of Volgard, and he performs in a band for himself. He plays keyboard in the band. So.
Cool, great.
He appreciates your comments. And by the way, he's going to accompany everybody. He's going to accompany us with St. Patrick's Day songs next Tuesday. It would have been this morning, but it's going to be next week. So everybody, be sure to come early.
So I've got a question if I can just throw it in here. Have you ever come, thank you very much, Mark. Very interesting. Have you ever come across any of his sacred music?
Yes.
Come Sunday is I sing in a church choir, and the beauty of the melody, and you think of a church setting and you're kind of contemplating and relax, just beautiful.
Come Sunday is, I think, a classic of American music, full stop, not just jazz. Mm-hmm. There is an absolutely gorgeous gospel version that was done by Mahalia Jackson with Duke Ellington. Mm. Mm. Yeah. The sacred concerts, the three sacred concerts, concerts of sacred music that Ellington did during his life, he clearly saw as very important. Now, a lot of critics have kind of deemed that these music are inferior Ellington, that they're not as good as some of the other stuff that he's done. I understand why they would say that, but I am not sure I agree. I don't think it's necessarily inferior. I think it's a situation when most of what you do is five-star stuff. When you do something that's four stars, people tend to put it down. But compared to what most everybody else does, it kicks the hell out of them. You know what I'm saying? And so it's a question of you end up kind of comparing Ellington's music to itself. And to those who find the concepts of sacred music as somehow less than, I think they're just comparing it to sort of the Himalayan peaks of what he achieved elsewhere. And well, okay, fine, I accept that judgment, but in absolute terms, the concerts of sacred music are remarkable achievements and they should be respected.
Thank you, and I think it really is time to wrap it up. Jim?
Yes, it is. Jim Blinn.
So, wow, Marcel, thank you so much for a really, you know, fascinating tour of Duke Ellington's, both his pianism and his influence on other people. It's clear that you excited quite a few of the members of the old guard. So, and thanks to Joel for running the music as you needed it. And Paul for his insertion of the pictures that helped too. So as you know, from attending our meetings in the past, we always give you a certificate of appreciation, which of course I can't hand to you today, but Joel is putting it up on the screen for you to enjoy briefly. And you know the story behind the orchids of the Old Guard was formed in 1930 when Summit was the orchid capital of the U.S. used distribute orchids all over the country and the world for that matter. So that's why you see the orchid. And the other way we have of thanking you is through the old guard salute. So we would all stand up, but we'll just clap instead.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcel, for what I think was a fascinating program. There was so much in it I couldn't capture at all, so I'm probably going to want to see the recording that Paul is making when it's available. But we really appreciate it. And so we have a meeting next week, and after about 10 minutes, so maybe at 12:15, on this Zoom channel, there will be a timely topics discussion. And let's see, does somebody want to make a comment about what Timely Topics is about this week?
Well, it's about homelessness, and we'll get to